next lecture in lecture series of fruits and vegetable processing, that is canning. So we'll see what is canning, what are the effects of canning on foods which you are canning, what are the spoilage of foods which take place while you can the foods, and what are the other different canning procedures or processes in canning. So what do you mean by canning? So canning is a preservation technique where you seal the cans by implication of heat. So canning is defined as a preservation of foods in hermetically sealed containers, and usually implies heat treatment as the principal factor in prevention of spoilage. So in canning, you give the heat treatments to the foods where the shelf life of the foods will be increased, as well as you prevent the spoilage of foods. Canning is a method of preserving food by first sealing it in airtight jars, cans or pouches. So canning is a preservation method where you first seal the foods in an airtight container. These container may be jars or cans or any other pouches or bottles. Then heating it to a temperature that destroys contaminating microorganisms that can either be of health or spoilage concern. So after sealing the food in these airtight containers, these will be treated with a heat temperatures to avoid the contamination of microorganisms. So these microorganisms may be desirable or undesirable microorganisms. So because of the danger posed by several spore forming thermoresistant microorganisms such as Clostridium botulinum. So mainly canning will eliminate the microorganisms which cause the danger to the health of people. So this canning is mostly done to prevent the microorganism which is Clostridium botulinum. This is a thermal resistant microorganism which can live at a high temperatures. So to eliminate these type of microorganisms which are thermal resistant, we will do this preservation technique, which is canning. So canning was invented by Nicholas Appert in the year 1910. So canning was introduced by a scientist by Nicholas Appert in the year 1910. Hence it is known as appertization. So canning is also known as appertization. So why do we need to can the foods? Why the canning has to be done to the foods? So fresh foods spoil or lose their quality for several reasons. So these are the reasons why we need to can the foods in the fresh foods. So these fresh foods should not be spoiled or should not lose their quality in their further use. So these are some reasons why these fresh foods will be spoiled. So first one is growth of undesirable microorganisms. So the undesirable microorganisms which are growing in your fresh fruits should be eliminated. Second one is activity of food enzymes. So enzymes that lead to chemical reactions like browning or any other reactions or any other physicochemical changes will take place. So to avoid these physicochemical changes, we are doing canning. Third one is reactions with oxygen. So oxidation is the major reaction that undergoes in fruits which lead to spoilage of your foods. Last one is moisture loss. So if the moisture loss happens in fruits and vegetables, there will be a shrinkage or shriveling of the fruits and vegetables that lead to the spoilage of these fruits and vegetables. So these are the different reasons why we need to do, or how your fresh foods become spoiled. which of the foods are to be canned? So, what are the types of foods which have to be canned in this canning procedure? So, the first one is low acid foods. So, low acid foods are the foods which have pH from 5 to 6.8. So, these foods, for example, are meat, fish, poultry, dairy, etc. So, these foods which have a pH around 5 to 6.8 come under low acid foods. So, the second one is acid foods. So, the acid foods have the pH ranging from 4.5 to 3.7. So, these are acid foods, for example, pear, oranges, apricots or tomatoes. So, the fruits which fall under, the fruits fall under this acid foods category. So, the next one is high acid foods. So, the high acid foods are pickled products and fermented foods. So, now these high acid foods are usually the foods which we pickle, which we salt. So, the process of pickling will take place in these high acid foods or fermented foods. So, fermentation will be taking place in these high acid foods which have pH around 3.7 to 2.3. So, these foods are examples, jams, jellies. So, jams and jellies will have high acidity which are prepared from your acid foods like fruits. So, the next is the types of canning. So, what are the different types of canning or how we can can foods? So, first one is pressure canning. So, in pressure canning, we will apply high pressure and high temperatures to the foods and the and at 116 degrees Celsius to 130 degrees Celsius. So, foods with low acidity needs sterilization by canning under conditions of both high temperature and pressure. So, the foods which have low acidity have to be sterilized under high temperatures and high pressures. So, this type of canning procedure is known as pressure canning, where you apply high pressure for the sterilization of these foods. So, the second one is water bath canning. So, water bath canning is the procedure where the canning occurs in the boiling water. So, the only foods that may be safely canned in a boiling water bath without high pressure. So, the pressure canning is for applying high pressures, but in water bath canning, there won't be any high pressures. And the foods which have to be water bath canned are the foods which have pH below 4.6. So, the foods which have pH below 4.6 undergo the water bath canning without any pressure. So, this is the pressure canning procedure, where you have a pressure cooker like thing and you will place your containers inside this pressure cooker and apply a high pressure. So, this is water bath canning. Where you will take a vessel with water, boiling water, and you will put your container inside this and you will close it with the lid, and the temperature, the boiling water gives the temperature for the sterilization of the foods or the cans. So, these are the two types of canning canning procedures, which are high pressure canning and also water bath canning. So, one is with pressure and other one is without pressure. So, now coming to the processing of canning. How canning occurs? What is the process of canning? So the first one is selection of fruit. So you will select the fruits which are able to be canned or which are stable when you can those fruits and vegetables. So second one is grading. So you will grade the, after getting the fruits and vegetables, you will grade them separately and choose the best one without any cuts or bruises to it, to avoid the further reactions and further future spoilage of those canned foods. Third one is washing. After you grade your fruits or vegetables, you will wash the fruits and vegetables so that the surface dust or surface bacteria or microorganisms which are present may be removed. Fourth one is peeling. So for some fruits, you need to peel the fruit and then you need to can the fruit for higher quality. So after washing, you will peel the fruits. Next one is cutting. So some of the fruits need to be cut into slices and then have to be canned. So such as peaches or pears. So these fruits have to be peeled and cut for the further processing of the canning. Next one is blanching. So blanching is a procedure which will be mostly done for vegetables. So blanching helps to remove the surface microorganisms and also inactivates the enzymes which are present in your vegetables or fruits which avoid the further reactions like browning reactions. So the seventh step in canning is cooling. So after blanching of these fruits and vegetables, you need to cool them for some time and then you need to proceed for the next step. So the next step in cooling is filling. So you will fill your food products or fruits and vegetables into cans and then syruping or brining takes place. So if you need salt has to be added, you will add a brine solution to your fruits fruits or vegetables after filling them into the cans. Or if you want to add sugar syrups, you will add the sugar syrups after filling them into the cans. So the next one is exhausting. So exhausting is a procedure where you will remove the air bubbles present on the top of present in the container after filling. So these air bubbles will be removed out so that there won't be any further reactions taking place like oxidations. Next one is sealing. So the 10th step in canning procedure is sealing. So sealing has to be done tightly so that there won't be further reactions or further spoilage of your fruits and vegetables present in the cans. Next one is processing. So after sealing your cans, the cans have to be processed, that is heat treated, so as to avoid the surface environment, as to avoid the other reactions which will be taking place with the can and the environment surroundings present around it. So after processing, the cans are to be cooled and then stored in a dry and clean environments or clean places, dry and clean and cool places, so that the shelf life of your food materials which are present in the cans will be increased. So let's see each and every step in detail. So the first step is selection of fruits and vegetables. So fresh fruits and vegetables should be chosen. So you need to choose fresh fruits and vegetables immediately after they are harvested to avoid the further processing in the fruits and vegetables. So to avoid the chemical reactions or chemical and physical changes in fruits and vegetables, you will choose the fresh fruits and vegetables immediately after harvesting. Fruit should be uniformly matured and firm. So all the fruits which are harvested should be uniform in nature, should be uniformly matured in nature, and also these should be firm. Okay, so softness, soft fruits or vegetables will be spoiled when you are canning them. So you need to choose a firm and uniformly matured fruits so as to avoid the spoilage in further steps. Overripe fruits are not to be chosen as they are more prone to microbial damage. So uniform mature fruits are chosen to avoid the microbial damage. If your fruits are overripened, so the microbial damage will be more. They are more prone to the microorganisms to attack them. So you will choose the uniform mature fruits which are not more ripened or not less ripened. So underripe fruits should be rejected because they get tough while canning. So while canning procedure takes place, these fruits will become tough, so hard. So you need to choose a uniform ripened fruits so as to avoid these toughness while canning. So underripe fruits will be getting tough while you are canning. So you need to choose a matured or a correctly matured fruit for the canning procedure. So next point is, it should be free from dirt. So dirt should not be there while you are choosing your fruits and vegetables. Should be free from cuts, bruises or any type of damage. So these fresh fruits and vegetables should be free from cuts or bruises so as to avoid the microbial damage or to avoid the chemical reactions going in it. So the second step is grading. So to obtain uniform quality selection is done according to the size and color of fruits and vegetables. So to get a uniform quality, so the quality should be uniform whenever you are canning, you are packing a product. So to you obtain this uniform quality of the product, you need to select the fruits and vegetables of the same size and same color so as to increase the quality of your product. This can be done by machines like graders or by hand picking. So this grading technique or this grading process can be done by graders, which will be grading based on the size or color or shape of your fruit, or it can also be done manually by hand picking. Some fruits are graded wholly while some are graded after they are cut into slices. So some fruits which are which we need whole fruits, these will be graded wholly. Like if you want mango, whole mango has to be canned. So you will grade the mango as it is. Or else if you want the sliced mangoes should be canned, so you will cut them into slices and then you will grade which is the better piece and which is the uniform, and you will grade the uniform pieces in the mangoes. So the next one is washing. To remove the pesticide spray residue and dust from the fruits and vegetables. So why washing is done is the main objective is to remove the pesticides which you are spraying while cultivating your fruits and vegetables, and also to avoid the dust which is present on the surface of fruits and vegetables. Removal of soil particles that contain microorganisms in it. And also the second objective is to remove the soil particles that contain microorganisms. So the soil particles are said to have thousands of microorganisms in it, which will cause the spoilage to your fruits. So to remove these soil particles, you will wash the fruits and vegetables. Different methods of washing of fruits and vegetables, like soaking them in 25 to 50 ppm chlorine, spray washing and or steam washing are done. So different types or methods of washing are present. You will dip your fruits in 25 to 50 ppm of chlorine, or you will spray wash them, or you also can steam wash them. So these are the different methods of washing your fruits. So next, coming to peeling. So the main objective of peeling is to remove the outer layer of fruits and vegetables to avoid the dust or microorganisms. So the objective of peeling is also same as washing, to remove the microorganisms present on the surface or to remove the dust particles which are present on the surface. So there are different types of n number of types of peeling procedures in like hand peeling. So, by hand peelers, you will peel the fruits or vegetables. Next, mechanical peeling. By using any machines, you will peel. Then, steam peeling. So, by applying the steam, you will the peel will be coming out. And also, lye peeling. So, by applying the caustic soda, you will peel the fruits or vegetables. So, these are the main different types of peeling present for fruits and vegetables. Next one is cutting. Main objective of cutting the fruits and vegetables is to remove the seed store or core present inside them. So the main objective of the cutting of any fruit and vegetable is to remove the seeds which are present in it. Like a mango contains stone inside it. So to remove that stone, you will cut the mangoes into slices and then you will can them. For some fruits, seeds cannot be taken out easily. These fruits are canned wholly without removing seed. So for some fruits, the seeds cannot be taken out. So these will be canned whole, the whole fruit will be canned. Next step in canning procedure is blanching. So blanching is done by boiling water for around 3 to 5 minutes. So blanching procedure is done by exposing the fruits and vegetables to boiling water or steam for about 3 to 5 minutes. So this is usually done for vegetables to inactivate the enzymes responsible for toughness, discoloration of flavors and loss of nutritive values. So why blanching is done is to remove the enzymes or to inactivate the enzymes which are responsible for the chemical reactions which lead to the toughness of the fruits, discoloration of the fruits, so which doesn't have a desirable color, of flavors which are undesirable flavors will be there, and loss of nutritive values. So to inactivate the enzymes which lead to these type of undesirable characteristics, you will do blanching. This also helps in reduction of microorganisms present on the surface. So apart from inactivating the enzymes that lead to undesirable characters, this blanching also helps in the reduction of microorganisms which are present on the surface of your fruits. So blanching is mainly done for vegetables because these are hard and fruits are soft. So the texture of the fruits will be soft, and if canned, they may be squeezed. So this blanching will be mainly done for vegetables. So the next step in after blanching is cooling. So the cooling has to be done for obtaining a better quality of vegetables. So vegetables are dipped in cold water for better handling and keeping them in good condition. So these vegetables are dipped in cold water or sprayed by cold water to get a good condition of these vegetables, and also by handling good handling of these vegetables. So the next step is filling of cans. Before filling, the cans are to be washed and sterilized. So before filling the cans, you need to sterilize the cans or wash the cans sorry, cans. Okay. So the next step after cooling is filling of the cans. So before filling of the cans, you need to wash and sterilize the cans. You need to wash and sterilize the cans so as to avoid the microorganisms present inside the cans. So automatic filling machines or hand filling can be used to fill the cans. So machines can be used or the hand manual filling can be done for filling the cans. Syruping or brining is done after filling, and the head space left inside the can should be around 0.32 to 0.47 centimeters. So after filling the cans, the syruping or brining, sugar syrups or salt solutions can be added. And so after filling the cans, syruping or brining can be done. So what syruping is adding of sugar syrups, or brining is adding of NaCl, that is salt solution. So the head space left after the brining and syruping is 0.32 to 0.47 centimeters. So the next step in canning process is exhausting. So exhausting is the process where you remove the air bubbles or air present in the cans. So the process of removal of air from cans is known as exhausting. Major advantages of exhausting. So what are the advantages of exhausting? It minimizes discoloration by preventing oxygen. So if you are doing exhausting, the air will be removed out, which prevents the oxidation reactions taking place inside the can. Reduces chemical reaction between the container and food. So this also helps in reduction of chemical reactions which will be taking place between the food and the can. It prevents development of excessive pressure and strain. So this exhausting also helps in the prevention of the strain and also pressure inside the cans. Better retention of vitamins. So this also helps in the retaining of vitamins which are present in your fruits and vegetables. So there are two types of exhausting methods. First one is thermal exhausting, second one is mechanical exhausting. So what is thermal exhausting? Thermal exhausting is the process where you apply steam with vacuum, and mechanical exhausting is the machine vacuum. So you can do it with steam, either steam or with the machines. So this is a type of thermal exhausting where you send steam inside the cans and remove the air bubbles outside. So the steam will be sent from here, and with air bubbles the steam will come outside. In the same way, the second side. So the next step in canning procedure is sealing. So sealing of cans is done by the means of a sealer machine. So the cans are sealed by means of can sealer immediately after exhausting. So immediately after exhausting, you need to prevent the entry of the air inside the cans. So you need to seal the cans immediately after you exhaust them. For glass jars, a rubber ring is placed between the mouth of the lid and the lid so that it can be sealed airtight. So for airtight, so to tight the cans or bottles, so jars, a rubber ring will be placed between the mouth of the can and also the lid. So this prevents the air from entering inside the cans. So the temperature of sealing should be always should not be below 74 degrees Celsius. So the next step in canning procedure is processing of cans. So heating of foods for preserving is known as processing. So you will, after filling, exhausting and also sealing, the cans should be processed by applying some heat. The cans must be heat treated immediately after the hermetic sealing at a suitable time and temperature. So at a suitable time and temperature, these cans after sealing should be heat treated so as to avoid the further reactions with the environment. Under processing of these cans may lead to bacterial spoilage, and over processing may lead to loss of nutritive quality. So if the processing is not done properly, it may lead to the spoilage by bacteria or microorganisms, and if you are processing the cans more, then it will lead to the loss of nutritive values. So the next step in canning is cooling. So immediately after processing, the cans are cooled at a temperature of 36 to 45 degrees Celsius in water. So these cans after processing have to be cooled at a temperature around 36 to 45, applying some water. It can be spray water, or you can dip the cans. This is done to avoid thermophilic spoilage or any rust. So why cooling is done? It is done to avoid the thermophilic spoilage by thermophilic bacteria, and also to avoid the rust formation on the cans. If the temperature is below 36, rusting may take place, and if the temperature is above 45, thermophilic damage may occur. So if the temperature is below 36 degrees Celsius for the cooling, then rusting may occur on the cans, and if the temperature is more than 45, there may be a thermophilic damage occurring in the cans. So the last step in your canning process is storage. So the cans should be stored in cool and dry place after they are labeled and kept in strong wooden boxes or corrugated cardboard cartons. So after canning, or after the process of this filling, sealing, exhausting and all, you need to store these cans at a cool place or dry place after labeling them. And these have to be kept in wooden boxes or corrugated cardboard boxes. To prevent the cans from rusting, their outer surface should be dry. So when cans react with water or oxygen, they will form rust. So to avoid that, you need to keep the surface of the cans always dry. The shelf life of the product may decrease if these cans are stored at high temperatures. So whenever these cans are stored at high temperatures which have high heat, the product shelf life will be decreased. Hello everyone, welcome to the next lecture in the lecture series of fruits and vegetable processing, that is effects of canning on food. So in the last lecture, we have already seen what do you mean by canning, what is the process of canning, what are the types of canning procedures. So today we'll see what are the effects of canning when you are canning your fruits and vegetables. So the first one is change in color. How color will be changed when you are canning your fruits and vegetables? The time temperature combinations used in canning have effect on naturally occurring pigments in foods. So depending on the time and temperature changes, there will be a change in the color, that is pigment, which is naturally in your foods. In fruits and vegetables, chlorophyll is converted to pheophytin. Carotenoids are isomerized from 5-6 epoxides to less intensely colored 5-8 epoxides, and anthocyanins are graded to brown pigments. So what will happen in fruits and vegetables is the chlorophyll will be changed to pheophytin. Chlorophyll will be changed to pheophytin. Carotenoids will be changed to 5-6 epoxides. Carotenoids will be changed to carotenoids which have 5-6 epoxides will be changed to 5-8 epoxides. So this 5-6 epoxides has the high intensity color, whereas 5-8 epoxides will have low intensity color. And these anthocyanins which are present will be changed to brown pigments. So what will happen? The color, the chlorophyll will be changed to pheophytin carotenoids which contain 5-6 epoxides which are high intensity colors will be changed to 5-8 epoxides which are low intensity colors, and anthocyanins will be degraded to brown color pigments. Discoloration of canned foods during storage occurs, for example, when iron or tin react with anthocyanins to form a purple pigment, or when colorless leucoanthocyanins form pink anthocyanin complexes in some varieties of pears. So for example, so in pears, the anthocyanins, the iron and the tin which is present will be reacting with the anthocyanins to form a purple pigment, or this colorless leucoanthocyanins which form pink anthocyanin complexes in pears. So this is an example of pumpkin, where this is the fresh pumpkin pulp and this is the canned pumpkin pulp. So the next attribute is flavor and aroma. So in fruits and vegetables, changes are due to complex reactions which involve the degradation, recombination and volatilization of aldehydes, ketones, sugars, lactones, amino acids and organic acids. So what will happen to flavor and aroma? There will be a certain reactions taking place, like degradation, volatilization and recombination of these aldehydes, ketones, sugars, amino acids, proteins which are present in the fruits and vegetables. So all these reactions will change the flavor of the canned foods from fresh foods. So the next attribute in your canning effects is texture or viscosity. So what happens when you are canning your fruits and vegetables? So when you are canning your fruits and vegetables, the fruits and vegetables become softer. The texture of fruits and vegetables will become softer than the unprocessed foods. So the texture of solid fruit and vegetable pieces is softer than the unprocessed food. So why this is softer? Because the solubilization of pectic materials and loss of cell turgor. So the pectin material or the pectin which is present in your cells of your fruits and vegetables will solubilize and convert the texture into smooth or softness. So the next attribute is nutritional value. So there will be a change in the nutritional properties when you are canning your foods. So the canning causes the hydrolysis of carbohydrates and lipids. So by the action of your water present in your fruits and vegetables, when you are canning, the hydrolysis takes place, that is the breakdown of your carbohydrates and lipids takes place in presence of water. But these nutrients remain available and the nutritional value of the food is not affected. So since they are available in your canned foods, so these will be available for your consumer to consume it, rather than it won't be affected by the canning. Proteins are coagulated. So as you already know, proteins in application of high temperatures will get coagulated and broken down. Reductions in lysine content are proportional to the severity of heating, but rarely exceed 25%. So the lysine which is present, the amino acid lysine, will be proportional to the heat you are supplying. So how much heat you are supplying to your canned product will be directly proportional to the lysine, decrease in the lysine content. So rarely it may exceed beyond 25%. Next, the loss of tryptophan. The loss of tryptophan and to a lesser extent methionine reduces the biological value of proteins by 6 to 9%. So the loss of tryptophan and methionine will be reduced by 6 to 9% in your canned products. Vitamin losses are mostly confined to thiamine, which are 50 to 75%, and pantothenic acid, which are 20 to 35%. So the vitamin content which is present in your canned products will be lost in the wake of thiamine and pantothenic acid. In canned fruits and vegetables, significant losses may occur in all water-soluble vitamins. So the water-soluble vitamins, that is B vitamin and C vitamin, will be lost very less. Rarely it may lost. Particularly the ascorbic acid will be lost. So next, coming to the spoilage that occurs when you are canning your foods. The incidence of spoilage in canned food is low. So the spoilage in your canned foods is rarely observed, but when it occurs, it must be investigated properly. But when the spoilage occurs, it should be taken proper care and also investigated so that you can avoid the further damage. During spoilage, cans may progress from normal to flipper to springer, soft swell and hard swell. So these are the damages that occur to the cans when you are canning. So flipper, springer, swelling, that is soft swelling or hard swelling. However, spoilage is not the only cause of abnormal cans, but overfilling, buckling, denting or closing. So these are the physical spoilage damages to your cans, that are overfilling of your cans, buckling or denting or closing of the cans. So these are also responsible for the damage, spoilage of canned products, rather than the only physical damage or microbial damage. It is mostly subjected to the physical, chemical and biological changes which lead to quality deterioration and untimely, ultimately spoilage. So there are three types of spoilages which occur in your canned products, that are physical, chemical and biological damages. So production of hydrogen, carbon dioxide, browning, corrosion are the chemical reactions. Production of hydrogen, which causes hydrogen swell. When you are in cans, when hydrogen is produced more, it becomes the swelling. So the cans will swell automatically. As same as carbon dioxide, when carbon dioxide is more in your cans, The swelling takes place which leads to the damage of the canned products. Browning reactions. So, the fruits which are present in your cans undergo chemical reactions which are browning. It may be Maillard browning or enzymatic browning reactions. Next, corrosion of cans. Whenever a moisture is present around the cans will get corroded or rusted. Due to the chemical reactions and liquefaction, gelation, discoloration of products due to enzymatic reactions. So, these all are chemical spoilage techniques, and liquefaction, gelation, discoloration are due to the enzymatic reactions. The key reasons for the microbial spoilage are less processing. So, if processing of your cans after exhausting is less or after sealing is less, it may lead to the microbial action. Insufficient cooling. So, after processing, if you are cooling the cans, if that is not done properly, microbial action takes place, that is thermophilic microbes may attack the cans. Contamination of the can due to leakage through seams. So, if you are the sealing is not done properly of the cans, then the leakage may occur, which may cause the microbial population to grow. And pre-processed spoilage. So, these are some of the microbial, the reasons for the microbial spoilage in cans. So, next coming to the chemical spoilage in cans. Hydrogen swell is the important type of chemical spoilage. So, as we have already known this, hydrogen which is released in the cans will have a swelling in the cans which leads to the spoilage of the canned foods. The hydrogen gas formed inside the can by the action of food acid on the iron of the can causes the can to swell, which is termed as hydrogen swell. So, the acid, the food, the acidity which is present in the foods will be reacting with the iron of the cans. So, this will lead to the production of hydrogen gas and ultimately the swelling occurs. So, the major causes of this hydrogen swell are, first one is high acid in the cans. So, if you are canning a high acid food material, this acidity, this acids will lead to the corrosion. Storage at high temperatures. So, if temperature increases, the hydrogen production will increase and it will lead to the swelling of the cans. Imperfection in tinning inside of the cans. So, sealing or exhausting of the cans, if imperfectly done, that may also lead to the swelling. Insufficient exhausting during cans. So, exhausting is removal of gases. So, removal of air from the cans. If this exhausting is not done properly, then the air present in the cans may react with the iron and corrosion may occur. Presence of soluble sulfur and phosphorus in the cans. So, this sulfur and phosphorus will react to the cans, react with the can material, and it will lead to the production of hydrogen. So, this results in the swelling of the cans. So, next, few of the swelling physical damages to the cans by chemical reactions are, first one is soft swell, hard swell, flipper, springer and leaker. So, soft swell is a bulge on both ends. If the can is bulged on both ends, it is soft swell, but not so tightly that the ends can't be pushed in, somewhat with a thumb press. So, this soft swell, if the cans are swelled on both sides and if you press that with your thumb, it may go inside, but it is not hard, it is so soft that it can go inside, the swelling may go inside. So, next one is hard swell. Is the swelling is so tightly bulged on both ends that the ends can't be pressed in. So, unlike soft swell, when you are pressing the swelled can, it may not go inside. So, this is hard swell, so which is tightly bulged. Next one is flipper. A can whose end normally looks flat but flips out when struck sharply or on the one end. So one end of the can will be flipping out, but it looks flat. So this type of damage is flipper. Next one is springer. A can with one end bulged out with sufficient pressure, this end will flip in and the other end will flip out. So one end of the can will be bulged and other end will be flat. When you press this end, the other end will be flipping out and this end will be flipping in. So the last one is leaker. A can with a crack or hole in the container that has caused leakage. So leaker is the is caused due to the improper of sealing. So sealing, if sealing is done improperly, then leakage may occur in the cans. So these are the few hydrogen swell or soft swell, and this is the good can. This one is flipper, this one is springer, and this one is swelling. So the next one is biological spoilage. So biological spoilage is due to the microorganisms which are present in the canned foods. So biological spoilage in the canned food caused by either survival of organisms after heat treatment or entry of microorganisms through leakage of the container after heat processing. So canned foods, when they are not properly heat treated, it may cause microorganism population to grow, which causes the biological spoilage in your canned foods. So the types of microorganisms involved in spoilage of canned foods are thermophilic bacteria and mesophilic microorganisms. So thermophilic bacteria, which grow at higher temperatures, and mesophilic bacteria or microorganisms that grow at optimum temperatures. First one is spoilage by mesophilic organisms. So this type of spoilage is caused by spore forming bacteria of genera Bacillus and Clostridium. So these are the two bacterial genus which cause the spoilage in your cans. Besides spoilage of lightly heated food like acidic foods, can also be caused by non-spore forming bacteria or even yeast or molds. Other than Bacillus and Clostridium, the spoilage may also occur due to the yeast or molds. Spoilage by mesophilic Clostridium and Bacillus species and sugar fermenting species of Clostridium like Clostridium butyricum and Clostridium pasteurinum cause the butyric acid type of fermentation in acid or medium acid foods. So these Clostridium species will ferment the canned foods which are present in it and release the butyric acid, which leads to the spoilage of your foods. This leads to swelling of container due to the production of hydrogen and carbon dioxide gas. So this these species of Clostridium and Bacillus will result in the swelling of container and production of these hydrogen gas and carbon dioxide gas. So this way the rusting takes place in the cans and production of microorganisms will take place. Next one is spoilage by thermophilic organisms. Major cause of spoilage of heat processed foods by thermophilic spore is due to under processing. So when you are doing after sealing of your cans, when you are processing these cans, if these cans are under processed, then the heat resistant microorganisms, which are thermophilic bacteria, may affect the canned foods. So spoilage by thermophiles includes flat sore, TA spoilage, that is thermophilic anaerobe spoilage, and sulfide spoilage. So flat sore, TA spoilage, and sulfide spoilages may be occur in your canned food due to thermophilic bacteria. So next one is discoloration of fruits products. So there are three types of browning reactions that occur in the canned foods. So besides microbial spoilage, the processed products may experience discoloration, which may cause various reactions brought by the action of enzymes, metallic contamination, or through the reaction between different components. So this discoloration may caused by enzymes present in your foods or metallic contamination of the cans. The metals present in the cans may react with the components present in the foods, and also reaction between different components. So the reactions between different components which are present in the foods may lead to the browning reactions. So first one is enzymatic, non-enzymatic browning, and metallic contamination. So these are the three types of discoloration reactions in fruits. So enzymatic browning is caused when the fruit is cut or peeled and oxidation of the phenolic compounds takes place. So enzymatic browning, as you already know, when the fruits are cut or peeled and canned, the browning takes place by the action of polyphenol oxidase. So this is the enzyme which is responsible for the browning reactions in your fruits, canned products. So this polyphenol oxidase will be reacting with your oxygen present in around the environment, and leads to the formation of melanoids. So these melanoids are the browning substances which are present in your fruits and vegetables or fruits. The browning can be checked by placing the cut and peeled fruit in 2-3% NaCl solution until used for canning. So whenever this browning reactions you need to check, you can check it by placing your fruits, cut fruits in the solution of NaCl, that is 2-3%. Next one is non-enzymatic browning. So browning of fruit products brought out by the reaction of other than enzymes is called non-enzymatic browning. So whenever enzymes doesn't act for the browning reactions, that is known as non-enzymatic browning. This can be the reactions can be of nitrogenous matter and sugar, nitrogenous matter and organic acids, sugar and organic acid, organic acids among themselves like ascorbic acid degradation and sugar degradation. So these are the four types of reactions that cause non-enzymatic browning in your canned foods. So first one is nitrogenous matter and sugar. Your carbohydrates, when react with proteins, this will the browning may take place. And nitrogenous matter and organic acids, so organic acids like ascorbic acid or citric acid may react with your proteins, then browning can take place. Sugar and organic acids, so the carbohydrates and the organic acids which are present in your foods may react and browning coloration will occur. And organic acids among themselves, that is ascorbic acid or citric acid, when react with themselves, this browning reaction may take place. So the last one in discoloration is metallic contamination. So the browning of canned fruits products is generally caused by the presence of iron and copper salts. So whenever this metallic contamination comes in view, that means the iron or the copper salts which are present in cans will be reacting with each other and browning reactions may occur and the brown color may be produced in your canned fruits. Important metallic contaminations in fruit products include, so these are the ferric, tannate, iron sulfide or copper sulfide. So these are the important contaminants which are present in your canned foods. So how can you control these spoilage reactions or how can you prevent the spoilage of canned foods? So these are common statements. You can eliminate your browning reactions or microbial spoilage or any other physical damages to your cans. So first one is use fresh products of good quality picked while cool if possible. So you should always pick the fresh quality fruits and vegetables or immediately after harvesting. If products must be held, keep in a refrigerator or spread out in a cool place. So these after harvesting these fruits and vegetables, these should be kept in cool place if the processing takes a longer time. Have jars and equipments clean in good condition. So the jars or the cans which you are using for canning should be in a very good condition so that the further damage doesn't occur. Seal food hot, either preheated or steamed in the cans. So the hot food should be sealed in the cans so that there won't be any microbial contamination in your canned foods. Process according to reliable time. So the processing of the cans should be taking place at the correct time so that you can avoid the damage or physical damage to your cans. Remove from processing promptly and cool carefully. So the after processing the cans, you need to cool the cans for certain time so as to avoid the thermophilic bacteria to attack on it. Test seals within 12 to 24 hours and handle carefully. So you need to check whether the sealing is done correctly or not, and for 12 to 24 hours after you are sealing the cans. Wipe jars, label and store in cool, dry, dark places. So these cans or jars should be kept in a cool and dry places so as to avoid the contamination of microbes or moisture or any other environmental factors. So these are some of the spoilage and prevention techniques for your fruits. Fruits and vegetables. For fruit juice, mold and prevention will be process fruit in boiling water, bath and etc. Then fruit juices, which the spoilage will be gas wells. How you need to avoid gas wells is use fresh clean fruit. Containers should be kept clean. Equipment should be clean. And berries, apples and all, hydrogen springers will be the spoilage. And how you need to prevent it by having food hot when it is sealing, and the containers should be full. There should not be any space left to the oxidation techniques. So thank you. Hope you have understood this lecture.